health department.
Through the health department.
Good morning and welcome to our Energize You series, episode number 44 of Questions and Answers with Shane Gregory and Ray Rodolfi. And we're still in the midst of the whole COVID scenario, the COVID environment with the social distancing. And so one of the things that we're particularly finding is people are taking less care of themselves than more care of themselves. It's always an opportunity. You can go one way or other, and any choices you make.
Black and white.
That's right. I mean, we're hearing that, of course, something that I thought about early in the piece was with all this sort of social distancing and physical distancing, it also means that people that you don't necessarily want to be in very close proximity all the time with others have too much of that,
yes.
Too much quality time.
Yeah.
And so it's like the incidence of domestic violence.
Yes. One of our clients, Dr. Mel, said that domestic violence has gone up, especially on children, actually. Adults and children up 400% in the last 7 weeks.
Yeah. So that's raising up local hospitals here.
Yep. Yeah. One of our clients is in charge and said that, they've really, one of the good things is that expectation they had for COVID hasn't been, they haven't had, like, they cleared out like a certain percentage of the hospital just for the COVID crisis. Yes. And the problem is they haven't had as much as they expected. What they have had is a uptake in domestic violence cases,
so
which are alcohol and drug related a lot of the time.
Yeah. So it's all the sort of like side effect scenarios of this whole social experiment, really, is what it is that's happening. So Shane and I were talking, one of my great interests is Buddhistic philosophy. So
yes.
I've always read about it, etc.
If I was going to pick a religion, it's the one I would pick.
Okay. So for me, I've really been thinking about it. There's information or philosophy about what we call the five hindrances. So the five hindrances towards allowing you to be happy. There's the concept of that, you know, we want to be happy to become joyful, and happiness is the path to joy. But it's actually the path to happiness is being happy. So the whole idea is that, you know, we need to live happiness in the moment, and these five hindrances prevent us from doing that. Now, once again, like everything, it's a choice. These are things we allow ourselves to get into. Now, these five hindrances are looking at like sensory influences on ourselves. It's the ill will that you may have to a situation to others. It's the busy mind that we constantly get, the automated negative thoughts or the monkey mind that comes into play. It's the concept of what Buddhists call sloth or torpor. Now, these are old words, but basically means being totally unmotivated, get out and do anything else. And then the fifth one is actually around being so indecisive or procrastination.
Yeah, I'm pulling the trigger.
That's it. So you'll find that when you're getting stuck in any of these, that you simply do not move forward. So we thought we'd just sensory stuff.
So Ray, this is a really good TED talk. We might put the link under in the comments when we finish doing this live stream. And Ray said it to me, like, me and Ray have a lot of similarities, and we also have a lot of differences, you know, with what personalities I have.
Differently similar.
Similarly different, you know. But Ray said in his TED talk, and it really goes through this. Now, the guy is speaker is a, he's a monk.
He's a shadow
monk that was born up in Germany, if that's what I remember rightly. And such an eloquent conversation. Like, he just kept the whole, you could see the whole audience was very captivated with what he said. It's very calm and peaceful, and it's almost like a sort of version of you, Ray, but probably put into a
without hair,
or kung fu, you know. But we'll definitely put a chat like a link for it. But I think I watched it. Ray sent me the link about a week. I think it was after our last. Last Thursday.
I watched these things to my clients, and I think I'll be.
I really got a lot out of it. You know, like I said, like I'm a pretty staunch atheist, you know what I mean? Personally, you know, nothing against people who use religion, but if I was going to pick one, I think the one that really resonated a lot with myself is Buddhism. You know, like I was brought up an Anglican Christian, you know, Church of England. I had a lot of friends that were from the Orthodox and Catholics, and you know, I had friends that were Muslims growing up, and I'm definitely not anti-religion, and everyone's got how they, you know, how they roll and how they're brought up, which is an impact. But yeah, this talk that this monk did was just so peaceful, you know what I mean? And the way he delivered it was in just such a warm, but it got point across, you know what I mean? It was a very powerful,
grounded.
Yeah.
So it's a, if you want, like a yin delivery, a soft delivery, or powerful information.
Yeah.
And it really does talk about like the senses of what a Buddhist called the five gates. So these are our senses of hearing, vision, smell, taste, and touch.
Sure. And guys, give us a one if you're watching this live. Give us a two in the comments if you watch this your own time. Just check it. And drop a comment if you've actually seen this video, because we will post it. And give us your two cents as well.
Yeah, absolutely. So it's a concept of how do we stop moving forward by getting caught up in that sensory sensation. So it may be simply, well, we know a lot of us turn to food,
yes,
for instance.
Alcohol.
And food, alcohol, drugs, but sex, touching, feeling, smelling, tasting, seeing, having pornography, all this stuff is working on the senses. And it stops you doing other things. So if it's something that you're doing for sensory stimulation for a short period of time, which actually activates you to do more stuff, well then this goes in there, yeah, okay, that's a good box. So for instance, you know, we're very much in health and fitness. So of course, going to the gym and exercising, going out for a run, doing martial arts, all this has, you know, lots of sensory.
Definitely.
And we feel positive when we do it. So sensory stuff is not a negative, but it's how you imply or comply in your life.
Yeah, I think it's how you analyze it, you know what I mean? Compartmentalize it and put it together. Like it's, definitely I think martial arts for me is one that brought together, you know, touch, maybe smell, not so much. But, you know, that's touch, vision, auditory, you know, like there's a whole, you know, like there's a whole bunch of different aspects of it that bring all over and heighten it, you know?
Yeah. So, and then for me, I would add the those non-physical senses of your intuition or your gut.
Creativity.
Well, and your heart, your compassion. So everything there, because we know we get caught up in relationships. We know we get caught up in all different aspects. So the idea is that really looking at that and seeing, okay, am I putting too much time in this? Like, I know for me, you know, watching a Netflix movie is being somewhere other than where I am. So it's a distraction at the best. So I think that's
reading
a good book, it's being somewhere other than where you are.
And mine's UFC on Sunday.
Alright, so let's look at number two, this idea of ill will. So this is usually like a negative feeling towards other people or a situation or just a concept.
Yeah. I personally have struggled with this one over the years. You know, like I was a very big grudge holder in my 20s, early 20s. And I think as I went through my 20s and I grew into a man, and I grew up now, you know, a middle-aged man, you know, I'm clean to being young, but...
I'm a middle-aged man.
I'm you're an old man. No, I'm joking. But I think he's an old man. But I think the thing of negative thinking is really one for personal growth. You know what I mean? For me, it was a massive one. Like, I got into a lot of personal development at age 25. I think I read two great books, Think and Grow Rich by Napoleon Hill, and How to Win Friends and Influence People.
Awesome.
Probably the meat and potato of personal development into wealth creation and treat people. And definitely changed my mindset along around negative ill will. This is something, you know, we all deal with now, you know, but I think now just when you're a little bit older, a little bit more relaxed, you know, I've got a very yang energy, learning to harness, I think that's what martial arts does for me, I probably think that's you, is learning to get all that sort of yang out, because after it, you feel quite chilled, you know what I mean? I know for myself, if I ever want to, I get really frustrated with something, the worst thing I can do is say something to them. The best thing I can do is go away and do some training, or do some meditation, or maybe both, sleep on it, come back, and it's a new day, you know?
Well, in my treatment therapies, I do one which is called Shiatsu, which is Japanese, and we're working with the energy system of the body, and we call a situation called Jitsu, which is when there's an excess of energy it gets stuck and doesn't move. And that might be the ache and the headache. Energy's
there. That what you mean?
That's right. Energy's there and stuck and doesn't move.
God, you must have it must be pouring out. That's a good question.
So this involves techniques of moving that.
Yeah, so a good question.
And that's what happens when you do your martial arts. You've got the pent-up energy, you get out there and you move the chi, which smooths the chi.
So what shiatsu? This is a question that's interesting, but I'm not a shiatsu expert by any means. I've been a client who was for a long 9-10 years or whatever it is. So different clients obviously get different things and need different things. Like when you train someone, you know, obviously everyone's, you've got different personality types, different parts of their life. Someone might be trauma, someone might be newly involved, someone might be da-da-da. So do you feel like with the energy movement you do with shiatsu that some people, that, like I'm a very high energy sort of person, so for me it's about moving it out. Is it about exiting the body or getting it to move quickly?
It's not exiting the body at all. It's for all of us, you know, we are an energy thing. In fact, there is a philosophy that we're an energetic being, spiritual being, living in a physical body, having a human experience.
Sure.
So it all comes with the energy. So the other side of that jitsu of the gathered in excess is what we call kia, which is an emptiness. So we need to draw energy there. Yeah. So within any body, it's like a jigsaw puzzle. It's all filled in there, but there's empty gaps here. And so it's more just balancing, moving energy around. For some people, like this negative ill will type, is quite often this type person is energy is all going up and out. Whereas, like this Shaolin monk, you'll see anyone who does a lot of meditative techniques, also quite often a lot of the more philosophical martial arts is more grounded. Meditation does. It grounds you.
There's two things that I get a lot of benefit out of, because I'm one of those sort of people. It's definitely treatments with you, okay? And I'm not saying that because, you know, for a business, I'm saying that because I genuinely
do. I don't know
what you're saying. Yeah, well, he doesn't, but I do. But I genuinely feel like I want to go home and cuddle my partner after it, or I want to go home and just relax. And meditation, there are two things. I mean, people walking past at the same time. But I think the two things I get, I'm someone that, like, we're going to talk about busy mind next, you know, so that's one thing that, you know, I do definitely have. But there are two things for me as a yang energy and as someone that's go, go, go. And I know a lot more people in society these days, because of iPhones and because of work and because we've got the internet and we can work 18, we can work 24 hours a day if we want. It's so important to work out how to ground yourself. The amount of clients that we, both of us, deal with that are just so burnt out, you know, and frazzled because they're not grounded and they're not, and I obviously don't understand the energy system, but I see it, you know, they've just got blockages. But
we just look at it in different eyes.
I just see it like this, why they're overweight and they're sleeping
so
like shit.
Let's just look at this and complete this ill will one. So one thing that struck me many, many decades ago, literally, when I first started studying all this back in the 80s, is that, and look, you know, I had a lot of anger as a young man as well. I went to three different schools in my last 4 years of schooling. Now, I was never a happy student as such. I was an academic honours student, I had the brains, and I was a sports student, but I was very anti-establishment all the time.
Yeah.
And that's carried on through my life, really. So, I had a lot of pent-up anger. And when I started studying all this stuff, I realised that we all have those people or situations that you think about and you go, oh, every time I see that person, they make me so angry. And, of course, this is the thing with all this domestic violence now. People are projecting their anger on other people, whereas the real philosophy of that is, every time I see that person, I make myself angry. And I make myself angry. It has absolutely nothing to do with them.
Yeah.
And that's the switch. Because when they make you angry, you have no control. When you make yourself angry,
you have no choice.
So, and of course, all domestic violence is people thinking that you make me so angry, you don't do this. We're not taking control of ourselves.
Sure. So, talk about sloth and toga. This is an interesting one.
Yeah, well, sloth and toga is really,
it's not a fault.
think of the animal, you say, oh, you're a lazy sloth. Because they're just slow, moving, just, and others might think they're just cruising. So for some people that might be a, yeah, that's the way I want to be, and for others not. Topa is the idea of a heavy mind, a heavy body. It's the energy, once again, is stuck. Energy needs to flow, and it needs to be flowing at high speed, if you like, different resonance, and sometimes it just needs to be sitting and settling, but still flowing within that. And that topa is the idea of being unmotivated, unstimulated, unactive. So you go nowhere.
Yeah.
This is, you can talk about this one.
Oh, jeez. Like, where do I start? Where do I stop? Yeah, I don't know. I think a lot of people, like, to get motivated, you know, and to get future, like, I'm a very motivated person. I always have been. It's a gift, you know what I mean? I think it comes back from probably the chip on the shoulder thing of, you know, like, I got told at school I was going to be a failure, but my teacher said you're going to be a loser, you know, picked on at school. So it wasn't that chip on the shoulder, but I think the big part of motivation is getting through that first 28 days of wanting to achieve something. You know what I mean? Like, it's so important. Like, it's 20, if someone can do something for 28 days and say they form 28 days form out, everyone's got the cliche thing. But I said, I did a live stream, did a real mindset thing on Saturday afternoon at 2:30. And I said, it takes 28 days to form a habit, okay? It takes 90 days to become part of your lifestyle, and it takes 3 years to do something that you do for the rest of your life, you know? And if you can do something consistently, and I think 28 days, most people can do that themselves, okay? Most people can. Some, okay?
It's getting small.
Yeah, 90 days, you probably need a coach of some sort, an accountability partner, whatever it is. 3 years, you have to have, like, you know what I mean? Like jiu-jitsu grading, you know, so we have in common. You're not going to do that watching YouTube videos. You might do it for 28 days, you might have a training night for 3 months, but to really get to that 3, 6, 9, 10, 12, 15, you know, how long have we been training together? 4 years? 13 years? Now, I've been training 17 years myself. You need to have that accountability part of the motivation. People think that they self-motivate. The percentage of people that can self-motivate is so low. I can't self-motivate myself. Reason why I think I'm reasonably motivated is, one, I know my why, and two, is I have so many different coaches around me. You know what I mean? I have so many different things. Even though I'm a bit of a yang and I've got that go, 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 look, I choose to listen to people. And I choose to be held accountable. You know, I love accountability. One, I practice what I preach, and two, it's the only way to win. You know what I mean? It's like a guarantee, like, it's the only way to do it, because the amount of people that can do it by themselves is so small, you know?
So we've got to look at that where, you know, you're in that situation being unmotivated, you need to break that vicious circle.
Sure.
You need to take the step out. And if that is asking someone else for help and saying, hey, come on, we go for a walk with me, and get someone else to say, call you up and say, let's go for a walk, let's do that run, let's do some meditation, let's do some yoga, let's do something that just breaks that cycle. Because you'll find that once you start, you can keep going. It's that getting started is a big thing.
Sure.
So the busy mind is what we call the monkey mind as well. It's a constant going all the time. And how do we settle that busy mind? With all of these things, the first thing is to acknowledge that that's happening for you. Find the potential tools that work for you to actually slow down that busy mind. Now, sometimes, what I said before is reading, watching movies, watching news things, documentaries, is taking you away from where you are. And sometimes that's very useful. So I will just sit and read for 5 minutes, just to slow my mind, to distract me, to then move on to the next thing. Or importantly, breathe. 5 minutes of meditation is a great way to do it.
The way to go to sleep, too. Let's talk about procrastination.
Procrastination, it's the thing that really slows us all down. And so it's being the person who's being indecisive. Now, I do remember in almost the business studies that you read so much about very successful people, and one thing is they make quick decisions and they stick with them.
That's it. So they jump and work it out on the way.
That's right. So the person who takes a long time to make a decision will quite often then not keep up with that decision. Now, those quick decisions will still be considered.
Yeah.
They will take into all the parameters. But relatively speaking, they're fast. And I've got to think about it. Like if you're ever doing sales and someone says, oh, let me think about it, you know, you've lost
You've lost it. Yeah. I think it's probably, as an entrepreneur, just this, right? That's one of my strengths. I just go. And I probably go a little bit maybe too far down in ways. But I think the reality to build a pretty long-term successful business, you need to make decisions, you need to move quickly, and you need to work it out. Like, not, I mean, you always, there's always great planning and structure is fantastic. It's important, it's essential with a certain size of business. You know, you're going to staff members and you know, X amount of clients and whatever. But I think one of the strengths I've always had is I just, you know, have a quick think, I assess the situation and go bam.
Yeah, I'm going to be in due diligence on it. Yeah. That might be very fast track for some people.
Yeah, and look, I have a fast mind, I have a busy mind. You know, but I've got a PT, so I'm going to let Ray finish off. And Ray, you have been very wise today. I'm learning a lot myself. But guys, give us a one of you watching this live. Give us a two of you watching this live. And also, on Saturday afternoon at 2:30, I am doing a Facebook Live Mindset Q&A, which is bringing someone in on the screen and doing coaching live. I've got a couple of really good questions. If you want any details, or if you'd like to ask your question on my show, which is Saturday afternoon at 2:30 p.m. Queensland Eastern Standard Time in Australia, please send me a PM or PM Ray if you're watching this Facebook Live. But I'm off to.
I'm going to finish now because I'm not going to say the only thing about making decisions, there's a risk.
Yeah.
And everything you do in life takes a risk.
Pull the trigger.
So you might make a decision, it may fail that first time, make a decision to move on and do something different.
Well done.
Thank you very much.
All right.
See you next time.
Have a week.
Stay safe and be alive.